नमस्ते, वेलकम टू 18CS44 MES सब्जेक्ट थर्ड मॉड्यूल एम्बेडेड कंप्यूटिंग एम्बेडेड सिस्टम कंपोनेंट्स सेकंड चैप्टर टिपिकल एम्बेडेड सिस्टम। इन दिस पर्टिकुलर सेशन वी आर गोइंग टू डिस्कस अबाउट द टिपिकल एम्बेडेड सिस्टम, पर्टिकुलरली ऑन कोर ऑफ द एम्बेडेड सिस्टम। वी आर गोइंग टू डिस्कस the various parts available in the in a embedded system in detail. Typical embedded system. A typical embedded system is given in the following figure. You can see over there, contains a single chip controller which act as the master brain of the system. See, in this particular figure you can find four or five different main parts. The first part is the controller, second part is the embedded hardware software system, third part is the memory section, and fourth part is the input or output devices connected to the embedded system. The first part is the controller, which is the main processing unit of the embedded system. And this controller or processor can be a microprocessor like Intel 8085, or maybe a microcontroller like Atmel 8089C51, or it may be a field programmable gate array FPGA device provided by Xilinx Spartan, or it may be digital signal processor, that is a DSP processor from analog devices, or even it may be application specific integrated circuit ASIC, or it may be application specific standard product ASSP like ADE7760 provided by analog devices for energy measuring or metering applications. So this is the first part. Any one out of these, like a microprocessor, microcontroller, field programmable gate array, digital signal processor, or application specific integrated circuit, or application specific standard product may be the controller within the embedded system. The second part is the hardware or software, embedded hardware or software system. Basically designed to regulate a physical variable or to manipulate the state of some devices. Hardware and software provided in the embedded system are basically designed to regulate the physical variables as well as manipulate the state of some devices. How they are going to manipulate or regulate the physical variable? It is by setting or sending some control signals to the actuators or devices connected to the output port of the system. Actuator is a device which is going to control the output in response to the input signals provided by the end user or the sensors which are connected to the input port. See, in this particular embedded system we have seen hardware or software system. What happens here? Variables or physical variables will be regulated or manipulated by the control signals, sending control signals to the actuators, right? How the actuators will be actuating upon the output? It is by the input signals provided by the sensors. So here there is a reactive system will be implemented. Hence sometimes embedded systems are also called as reactive systems. The first part is controller, second part is embedded hardware software system, and third part is the memory. So memory of the system is responsible for holding the control algorithm, that is the code the user or the application programmer writes, and other important configuration details. This is the third part. And coming to the fourth part, that is the IO devices, keyboard, push button, switches, etc. are example for common user interface input devices. Similarly, LEDs, LCDs, then the piezoelectric buzzers are examples for common user interface output devices. So in this particular topic, we are going to see about controllers. Next topic, we are going to see about memory. Next, about the hardware as well as the software, as well as finally I/O devices. That's all about this particular chapter. So first, about the controllers, we have microprocessor, we have microcontroller, we can have a field programmable gate array, we can have digital signal processor or application specific integrated circuit or even application specific standard product ASSP. Core of the embedded system. Embedded systems are domain and application specific and are built around a central core. The core of the embedded system falls into any one of the category. Four different categories are available, like general purpose and domain specific processors, application specific integrated circuit, then programmable logic devices, and commercial off the shelf components, CODs we call in simple. So general purpose and domain specific processors could be the microprocessors, or it could be the microcontrollers, or even it could be the digital signal processors. So first we will see the general purpose and domain specific processors. Almost 80% of the embedded systems or processors are controller based. The processor may be a microprocessor or a microcontroller or a digital signal processor, depending on the domain and application. Microprocessor as well as microprocessor we have seen in detail in our first unit discussion. Once again, just to recall, microprocessor is a silicon chip representing the central processing unit, which is capable of performing arithmetic as well as logic operations. CPU contains the ALU, control unit, and working registers. Microprocessor is the dependent unit. The meaning of dependent unit is it do not have its own memory. However, we need to interface memory to the microprocessor. Microprocessor do not have interrupt controller, timer unit, etc. So it is called as a dependent unit. The first microprocessor have been developed by the Intel, that is Intel 4004, which is a 4-bit processor during 1971, during November of 1971, used for old days calculators. In 1974, Intel launched the first 8-bit microprocessor, Intel 8080, with the 16-bit address bus and program counter, and 7 8-bit registers. Intel 8080 was the most commonly used processor for industrial control and other embedded applications during 1975. Immediately after the release of Intel 8080, Motorola also entered the market with their processor, that is Motorola 6800, with a different architecture and instruction set compared to 8080. Then during 1976, an upgraded version of 8080 has been introduced by Intel, which is named as Intel 8085, with the two newly added instructions, three interrupt pin and serial input output. Clock generator and bus controller circuits were built in this particular 8085 processor. In 1976, Zilog entered the microprocessor market with Z80 processor as a competitor to the Intel. Intel, AMD, Freescale, Global Foundries, TI, Cyrix, NVIDIA, Qualcomm, MediaTek, etc. are the key players in microprocessor market. Intel leads the market with the cutting edge technology in the processor industry. In the small figure given over there, you can see the components of a microprocessor, like arithmetic logic unit, control unit, and register, general purpose register array, and input device, output device, as well as memory will have to be interfaced to the microprocessor. They are not available, so it is called as a dependent unit. That is dependent unit. Yeah. So next is regarding the microcontroller. A microcontroller is a highly integrated chip that contains a CPU, the scratchpad, random access memory, a special and a general purpose register, on-chip read-only memory or a flash memory for program storage, timer, interrupt control unit, and dedicated I/O ports. Microcontroller can be considered as a superset of microprocessors. A microcontroller contains all the necessary functional blocks for independent working. They found a greater place in the embedded domain in place of microprocessors. They are cheap, cost-effective, and readily available in the market. The first microcontroller introduced by Texas Instruments, TMS1000 during 1974. It is followed by Intel's 4004 4-bit processor. Some amount of RAM and program storage memory and I/O support is given on the chip. 1977, Intel entered the microcontroller market with a family of controllers coming under the name that is MCS48 family. Intel came out with its most fruitful design in the 8-bit microcontroller domain, the 8051 family, and its different versions. 8051 is the most popular and powerful 8-bit microcontroller ever built, developed during 1980s, and was put under the family MCS51. Almost 75% of the microcontrollers used in the embedded domain were 8051 family based microcontrollers during 1980s and 90s. 8051 processor cores are used in more than 100 devices by more than some 20 independent manufacturers, including Maxim, Philips, Atmel, etc., under the license from Intel. Due to low cost, wide availability, memory efficient instruction set, mature development tool, and Boolean processing capability, Intel's 8051 is the most popular microcontroller. 8051 family derivative microcontrollers are much used in high volume consumer electronic devices, entertainment industry, and other gadgets where cost cutting is essential. Here is the difference between the microprocessor versus microcontroller. I think I have given the same table in our first or second module discussion. So I feel students can go through this one and they can able to understand. Next is the digital signal processor. Our powerful special purpose 8, 16 or 32-bit microprocessors designed specially to meet the computational demands and power constraints of today's embedded audio, video and communication applications. DSPs, that is digital signal processors, are 2 to 3 times faster than the general purpose microprocessor in signal processing applications. They are implement algorithms in hardware which speeds up the execution, whereas general purpose processors implement the algorithm in firmware, that is software, and the speed of execution depends primarily on the clock of the processor, that is something in relation with the RISC architecture and CISC architecture. Complexity lies in the hardware, not in the software, so programmer's burden will be less. DSP can be viewed as a microchip designed for performing high speed computational operations for addition, subtraction, multiplication, as well as division. A typical digital signal processor incorporates the 4 key points like program memory, data memory, computational engine, as well as I/O units. Program memory used to save the code or the program written by the user. Similarly, data memory for storing the temporary variables, data, signal to be processed. Computational engine performs the signal processing in accordance with the stored program memory. incorporates many specialized arithmetic units as well as multiple hardware shifters are also used. I/O unit act as the interface between the outside world and the digital signal processor, which is responsible for capturing the signals, that is the input device, to be processed and delivering the processed signals, the output unit. Audio, video, signal processing, telecommunication and multimedia applications are the best examples for DSP, where DSP is employed. Then digital signal processing employs a large amount of real-time calculation, sum of products, then convolution, fast Fourier transform FFT, discrete Fourier transform DFT, etc. are some of the operations performed by the digital signal processors. Blackfin processors from analog devices is an example for DSP, which delivers breakthrough signal processing performance and power efficiency while also offering a full 32-bit RISC MCU programming model. In the following figure given there, you can just see the digital signal processor will be receiving the input from the sensors, which will be converted to digital, that is analog to digital converters we can observe over there. Optional filtering section can also be included before the input device as well as before the output device, that is after the digital signal processor. So once again, the processing is done in the digital signal processor and the result is converted to analog by using the digital to analog converter before it reaches the actuator for further processing. Next is the difference between the RISC as well as CISC processors or controllers. I think we have detailedly discussed this particular part in our second module, right? I think even I have given the same table over here, difference between the CISC and RISC. The term RISC stands for Reduced Instruction Set Computing. RISC processors processes lesser number of instructions, typically in the range of 30 to 40. CISC stands for Complex Instruction Set Computing. The instruction set is complex here and instructions are high in number. For a programmer's point of view, RISC processor are comfortable as he has to remember only minimum number of instructions compared to RISC. Atmel AVR microcontroller is an example for a RISC processor and its instruction set contained only 32 instructions. The original version of 8051 microcontroller is a CISC architecture, which included somewhere around 255 instructions. But one thing we have to remember here, that is regarding RISC and CISC, it is not the number of instructions that determines whether the processor is RISC or CISC, but some features like pipelining, instruction set type, etc. will be the deciding factor whether a processor is RISC architecture or CISC architecture. Pipeline features should be there in the RISC architecture, as well as instruction type. There should be minimum number of addressing modes, and all instructions should not access the memory. Only load and store instructions should access the memory. All these restrictions will be there in the RISC architecture. So, of course, the differences we have already discussed in the second module. So, let us move further to Harvard versus Wineman processor or controller architecture. Once again, we have seen the difference between Harvard and Wineman architecture in the second module. Just to recall, microprocessor or controllers based on the Wineman architecture shares a single common bus for fetching both instruction as well as data. So this may reduce the timing efficiency with regarding the Wineman architecture. Program instructions and data are stored in the common main memory. Wineman architecture based processor or controller fetch an instruction first, followed by data to support the instruction from the code memory. So two separate fetches will definitely slow down the controller's operation. Vanniman architecture is also referred as Princeton architecture, as it is developed by the Princeton University. Coming to the Harvard architecture, it will have separate data bus as well as control bus, which allows the data transfer and program fetching to occur simultaneously on different buses. The data memory can be read and written while program memory is being accessed. These separate data memory and code memory buses allow one instruction to execute while the next instruction is fetched. The concept of free fetching or pipelining will be introduced here. The free fetch theoretically also much faster execution than Vanniman architecture. So here is the these two figures shows about the difference of Vanniman architecture as well as Harvard architecture. You can find here CPU, the input output devices, as well as memory is commonly connected with a single shared bus in the Vanniman architecture, whereas in the Harvard architecture CPU do have separate buses for the program memory as well as the data memory. So the efficiency will be obviously more in the Harvard architecture. The differences are listed here. In Vanniman architecture, single shared bus for instruction and data fetching. Harvard architecture, separate buses for instruction and data fetching. Vanniman, chances for accidental corruption of the program memory is possible, but there is no chances in the case of Harvard architecture. Low performance compared to the Harvard architecture in Vanniman architecture. In Harvard architecture, easier to pipeline, so high performance can be achieved. Allows self-modifying codes in the Vanniman architecture, and in the Harvard architecture, no memory alignment problems will be possible. These are the main differences between Vanniman architecture as well as Harvard architecture. The next is the Big Indian versus Little Indian processor or controller. So once again, this particular topic we have discussed in the second module. So just to recall once again, Indianness specifies the order in which the data is stored in the memory by the processor operation. So suppose the word length is 2 byte, it is not applicable for the processors with the word length equal to 8 bits, 1 byte. It is for the processors or controllers where the word length is 2 bytes or more. So suppose the word length is 2 byte, then data can be stored in the memory in two different ways. The first method is a higher order data byte, 8 bit will be saved in the higher memory, and lower order data byte will be saved at a location just below the higher memory, that is in the lower memory. This is called as a Little Indian convention. So example, we can see in the following figure, a 4 byte long integer, that is byte 3, byte 2, byte 1 and byte 0 will be stored in the memory, that is the lowest memory address, that is 2 followed by 4 zeros in hexadecimal, will be saved with byte 0, that is 8 bit, then 2 followed by 20001 memory location byte 1 will be saved, 2002 byte location byte 2, and 2003 byte location byte 3 will be saved. So as the memory address increases, the higher order data will be saved. This is Little Indian. The reverse of that one will be the Big Indian terminology. Lower order of data byte at higher memory and higher order of data byte at lower memory is called as Big Indian. So once again, the same example, you can see the bottom figure here. Byte 3 is saved at location 20000. Similarly, byte 2, 2001, the reverse of the Little Indian. So the difference between Big Indian and Little Indian is clearly depicted in these two figures. Next is load store operation and instruction pipelining. The RISC processor instruction set is orthogonal, meaning it operates on registers. Orthogonal in the sense, any register can be used for any purpose. Multiplication, operation, addition operation, division operation, whatever the operation it may be, any register can be used. If you are using register R0 for a particular purpose, even R4 could be used for the same purpose. This is orthogonality of the registers. The memory access related operations are performed by the special instruction, that is load and store. Only load or store instructions are used to access the memory. No other instructions will be allowed to access the memory. Hence, the addressing modes will be very minimal. If the operand is specified as memory location, the content of it is loaded to a register using the load instruction. Similarly, the instruction store stores the data from a specified register to a specified memory location. Loading is always to the register and storing is always to the memory location. Concept of load store architecture is illustrated with the following example. Look into the figure here. You can find x, y and z. So x, y and z, three variables you can find over here, and my first instruction that I have given here, load R1 comma load R1 comma x, that means the content of x will be loaded to the register R1 here. The second instruction is load R2 comma y, that means the content of y will be loaded to R2 register. Then add R3 comma R1 comma R2. Contents of R1 and R2 are added together and result will be loaded to register R3. This is the third instruction, and fourth instruction is store R3 comma Z. That means the content of R3 will be saved into memory location Z. So that is depicted clearly in this particular figure. Don't get confused with the load and store instruction of ARM processor that you have studied. The first operand in the ARM, the first operand will be usually a destination operand. So this is not the same over here. For example, store R3 comma Z, R3 is the source operand here and Z is the destination operand. Content of R3 will be saved onto memory location Z. The conventional instruction execution by the processor follows fetch, decode, execute sequence, where fetch part fetches the instruction from the program memory or code memory, decode part decodes the instruction to generate the necessary control signals, execute stage reads the operand, performs the arithmetic logic operation and stores the result. The fetch decode operations are performed in sequence. Whenever the current instruction is executing, the program counter will be loaded with the address of the next instruction. In case of a jump or a branch instruction, the new location is known only after completion of the jump or branch instructions. I think all this part we might have already discussed. We have already discussed in the second module. So let me go with the next topic. It is about pipeline execution. Once again, the same topic have been discussed in the second module. Depending on the stages involved in an instruction, that is the pipeline can be three stage, pipelining can be three stage, five stage, six stage, right? Similarly, we have considered a three stage pipeline over here, that is a fetch, decode, execute. If it is five stage, fetch, decode, execute, access an operand, write back, all these are the different stages. So in this particular figure, you can see the fetch in the first clock memory cycle, not clock cycle, in the memory cycle, and decode in the second memory cycle, and execute will happen in the third memory cycle. Usually one memory cycle will be equal to four clock cycles in a microprocessor or in the controller. So you can see in the figure four clock pulses are given, which constitute one machine cycle, where fetch, decode and execute will happen. PC stands for the program counter here, and once the a particular instruction reaches the execute stage, you can find program counter will be pointing to PC plus 2 location, next address. Next is regarding application specific integrated circuit, ASIC. Application specific integrated circuit is a microchip designed to perform a specific or unique application used as replacement to conventional general purpose logic chips. Integrates several functions into a single chip and thereby reduces the system development cost. As a single chip, ASIC consumes very small area in the total system, and ASICs can be prefabricated for a special application, or it can be custom fabricated by using the components for a reusable building block library of components for a particular customer application. So these are some features of ASIC. To continue with the ASIC based systems are profitable only for large volume commercial production. So this is profitable for large volume commercial production because there is something called as non-recurring engineering charges, NRE in simple we call, and it is a one-time expense which will be very heavy. So ASIC will be profitable only for large volume commercial products. So futures of ASIC, that is NRE cost. So it is a future of ASIC as well as it is also the drawback of ASIC, that is large NRE cost, non-recurring engineering charges. And coming to the futures, once again, less complex ASICs are high performance, low power consumption. Coming to the drawback, inflexible design, updates require a redesign, then deployed systems cannot be upgraded because we have to design each and every time. Once again, the NRE cost will be high there. Complex and expensive development tool, mistakes in product development are costly due to NRE. So these are the some of the drawbacks as well as features of ASIC. See, there is no much difference between ASIC and ASSP. If somebody is ready to bear the NRE cost of ASIC, then it is called as ASSP. That is, if the non-recurring charges is bared upon by third party and application specific integrated circuit is made openly available in the market, the ASIC is referred as application specific standard product. You can see the difference between ASIC and ASSP in the particular table given over here. First thing is ASIC microchip designed to perform a specific application, and ASSP, it is also similar to ASIC, but if the third party is ready to pay the NRE cost, ASIC is made available to the market, then ASIC is referred as ASSP. Most of ASICs are proprietary product, and ASSPs are openly available in the market. These are the difference between ASIC and ASSP. Next topic is a general purpose processor versus application specific instruction set processor, that is GPP versus ASIP. GPP is a processor designed for general computation task, that is the day-to-day laptops or desktop, whatever we are using, the processor running inside our laptop or desktop like Pentium 4, AMD, etc., etc. Production in large volumes, per unit cost for a chip will be very low. GPP contains an arithmetic and logic unit as well as a control unit. Coming to application specific instruction set processor, ASIP, they are processors with the architecture and instruction set optimized to specific domain or application requirement. It is not the general one as for designed for GPP. So here the instruction set is optimized, that is very minimal and designed only for the special purpose or application as per the requirement. Like the applications may be like network processing, automotive, then the telecom, media applications, digital signal processing, control applications, etc. ASIPs incorporate a processor and on-chip peripherals demanded by the application requirement, program and data memory. Then programmable logic devices, PLDs. I think you have studied this PLDs, programmable logic devices, in your third semester in the subject analog and digital electronics, and you have seen three different categories over there. One is a programmable read-only memory, PROM. Second one is a PAL, programmable array logic, and third one is a PLA, programmable logic array. So there is a set of input array and there is a set in the output array also. Any Boolean expression or logical expression can be implemented in these programmable logic devices. With the several examples you have discussed in ADE subject in your previous semester. So let me brief over here. Logic devices provide specific functions including device to device interfacing, data communication, signal processing, data display, timing and control operations, and almost every other function a system must perform. Logic devices can be classified into two broad categories, like fixed or programmable. PLDs offer customers a wide range of logic capacity, features, speed and voltage characteristics. PLDs can be reconfigurable to perform any number of functions at any time. So this is the most beautiful part of PLDs. It can be reconfigurable by the user. Advantages of PLDs. Programmable logic devices offers a number of advantages over fixed logic devices, which includes customers much more flexibility during the design cycle, because changing the programming file is in the programmer's hand. Anytime he can change that one as per the requirement. PLDs do not require long lead times for prototypes or production, because it is a simple AND array as well as OR array will be the design of a PLD. So production time will be very minimum. PLDs do not require customers to pay for large NRE cost, non-recurring engineering cost will not be there. Then PLDs allow customers to order just the number of parts they need when they need them, allowing them to control inventory. PLDs can be reprogrammed even after a piece of equipment is shifted to the customer. So these are the main advantages of PLDs. Next topic is about CPLD and FPGA. CPLD stands for Complex Programmable Logic Device, and FPGA stands for Field Programmable Gate Array. These two are the major types of programmable logic devices. FPGAs offer the highest amount of logic density, the most features and highest performance. The largest FPGA now shipping part of the Xilinx Vertex, so which you have used in your previous semester laboratory, that is analog and digital laboratory, the Xilinx software provided by the Spartan Vertex. So the difference between CPLD and FPGA is given here. CPLD, PLD is used for construction of CPLD, whereas logic blocks are used for construction of FPGA. CPLD is non-volatile and less costly, but FPGA is volatile and little bit costly compared to CPLD. Delays are much more predictable in CPLD, unpredictable delay in the case of FPGA, or predicting delay will be difficult in FPGA because it is made up of logical blocks. Then operating speed is low and suitable for control circuit. It is for CPLD. Coming to FPGA, operating speed is high and suitable for timing circuits. CPLD has less flexibility and design capability. FPGA has more flexibility as well as design capacity. CPLD could work immediately after power up. FPGA could not work until the configuration is done. Minimum basic configuration is to be done for FPGA before putting on to the work. CPLDs are considered as coarse gain devices, whereas FPGA are considered as fine grain devices. So in the next topic, you can see the difference between FPGA as well as ASIC. FPGA is a programmable integrated circuit, whereas ASIC is a unique type of integrated circuit meant for a specific application. Next is, FPGA is not efficient in terms of use of materials. ASIC waste very little materials, recurring cost is low. FPGA is better than ASIC when building low volume production circuits. Cost of ASIC is low only when it is produced in a large quantity. Then FPGA is alterable, but ASIC, once it is created, it no longer be alterable. Then FPGAs are used for research and development activities. Prototype fabrication using FPGA is affordable and it is also fast. ASICs are not suitable for research and development purpose as they are reconfigurable. One last topic in this particular session, that is a commercial off-the-shelf component, in simple COT or COTS produce product. COTS product is one which is used as is. It is just plug and play. COTS products are designed in such a way to provide easy integration and interoperability with the existing system components. The COTS components may be developed around a general purpose or domain specific processor or an application specific integrated circuit or a programmable logic device. Examples of a COTS hardware unit are remote controlled toy car, control units including the radio frequency circuitry part, high performance, high frequency microwave electronics, high bandwidth analog to digital converters, devices and components for operation at very high temperature, electro-optic IR imaging arrays, UV or IR detectors, etc. Major advantage of COTS: COTS are very cheap, readily available in the market, and developer can cut down the development time to a great extent, so it reduces the time to the market regarding the embedded systems. Examples are TCP/IP plugin module available from various manufacturers like Vesnet, Freescale, Dynalog, etc. are very good examples for COTS. So you can see in the figure also I have given that one. And benefits of COTS based system: reduce the development cost, reduce the software life cycle, improve software development process to reduce coding, debugging, unit testing and code inspection. So this is all about today's topic. The next topic is memory, that I will continue in the next session. Before going further, the important questions in this particular session, regarding this particular session, is first one is, what is digital signal? Before that, explain the components of a typical embedded system in detail. Components of embedded system, as we have discussed, the same thing you have to write in your notes. I have given from page number 8 to 17. Then differentiation, like microprocessor versus microcontroller, CISC versus RISC, Von Neumann versus Haber architecture, big Indian versus little Indian processor, ASIC versus ASSP, CPLD versus FPGA, then FPGA versus ASIC. So any difference could be asked in the examination, must be ready. Another question could be about, what is a digital signal processor? Explain the role of DSP, in embedded system design. In page number 9 and 10 of your notes, I have explained this one regarding digital signal processing. Next question could be, explain the concept of load store architecture and instruction pipelining along with that particular figure XYZ R1, R2, R3. You can explain this one. In page number 13 and 14, it is given. One more question could be, what is an programmable logic device, that is PLD? What are the different types of PLDs? Explain advantages of PLDs in embedded system design. So page number 15 and 16 of your notes explains this. That's it for now. Happy learning. Bye.